Hinduism has had huge amounts of contributions to what we now call mind sciences, cognitive sciences, neurosciences, which has just been discovered in the last 30, 40 years. It's become a rave to talk of mindfulness, meditation, or the effects of yoga or something like that on various things about the body, and experiences of higher states of consciousness that people are now able to start measuring and evaluating, things that the rishis and yogis have claimed for a very, very long time. So this particular area is very cutting edge. It's very, very much where the new Nobel Prizes are going to come. And yet it involves areas where our tradition has unparalleled expertise. And in fact, it's a bit of a shame that much of this research is being done in the West, even though the practitioners are in India, but the research on these is being done in the West, and the writing of papers and getting credits and filing for, you know, patents and discoveries and naming things is a lot of it being done in the West. It's kind of a shame. It's not that people who are from the practicing side are not allowed to, they're just not doing it, which is tragic. Now, if you look at the nature of discovery in our tradition, it follows a lot of parallels with science. Because when you look at in science, what does science consist of? It is not a set of truths or a set of outcomes, but a set of methods. Science is a set of methods. You follow certain methods, and then you get the outcome. So it's not that this science means E equals MC squared, it means this, that, that. Those are the outcomes. But the methodology is that it has to be empirically based, so you should be able to verify it. Yeah, it should be reproducible. So if somebody has done an experiment, then others should be able to replicate it. It should be independently verifiable. So people who have no vested interest should be able to verify it, and so on. Similar approaches have been carried out by ancient rishis in a different kind of empiricism, which is the inner empiricism, which is creating a silence, which is like a clean room laboratory would be, creating a silence. And in that silence, which is an inner laboratory doing experiments with where do this thought come from, observing, making inner observations, and being able to come up with insights which ordinarily our minds are not able to comprehend, or our minds are not able to cognize these kind of insights. So rishis have had some phenomenal insights without the benefit of external instrumentation. So the West certainly has pioneered and done very well in what we call instrumentations of the external kind. And Indians have done very well in a kind of an internal instrumentation also. That could be thought of as an instrumentation, the mind being an instrument which can be developed, can be cleaned, and turned into a system of observation. Now, the reason we are sure that the rishis had something going is because there are mantras which give you the velocity of light. And there is no instrument known in any of our texts that somebody used. And the velocity of light comes out pretty accurate. It's not as accurate as today's instruments will tell you, but pretty accurate. In fact, at a time when people in most of the world did not even think that light had a finite velocity, most people thought that it's infinite velocity, it's instantaneous. So even the idea that there's a finite velocity and here is a formula how you calculate it, and the formula is 98% or so accurate, is absolutely phenomenal. And then things like, you know, calculating the value of pi to several places pretty accurately. You go on and you find a number of observations which are validated, but these observations came out through a kind of an inner intuition in a state of consciousness which others replicated, because it's rishis replicated what other rishis had discovered. So there is this kind of a peer review equivalent, that somebody says that a certain meditation or a certain practice gets you some experience, then others can be taught that. It is not that you have to be a specially chosen prophet from God, none of them were, but it's a human potential that every human has. So somebody can discover it and others can learn, and they can also try it. So this idea of an empirical approach, although this being an inner empiricism, We call it Adhyatma Vidya, and being able to replicate it, being able to demonstrate it with independent people is very similar to some of the qualities of science.